Ma'am. Sir. Ma'am. Ma'am. Salvo. Yeah.
Why not?
My man.
For practical purposes, I know that Anonymous had the bottom of the depth in the squad. What's the best way to record that, the video, so we can really see how well we're doing?
That's an excellent question. I was talking to somebody about it earlier, but I'm not sure you heard, and it bears repeating, so thank you for bringing it up. So if you are lifting on your own, and even if you're not, you should be using video, right? You should all be using video. And there are excellent resources at the Starting Strength website about the proper way to use video to record your lifts so that you can look and get some visual feedback on what it is that you're actually doing. For the issue of depth, the sweet spot for the squat is like that three-quarter rear view. That's why your coach spends most of his time standing there. But you notice he doesn't spend all of his time standing there. He walks around, right? I probably spend a little bit more time in front than some coaches because I'm a real Nazi about knees out, right? For depth, looking straight on from the side, right? If you do the three-quarter rear view and you look at depth and your depth is, you know, maybe just below parallel or just above parallel, I find that looking at that view on video, it gets real easy to lie to yourself, right? But from the side, right from the side, the profile view, you can't lie to yourself. You can see the hip crease and you can see the top of the knee, and that hip crease is either below the knee or it's not. And if it's not, the squat is high, right? Period, right? So if you're worried about depth, so I'm in a place right now where I'm usually doing like four work sets on heavy day, four or five work sets on heavy day. I'm doing three work sets on light day. I'm doing two work sets on medium day. I make sure that at least one of those work sets I am videoing from the side, all right? I try to do, you know, a few from the three-quarter rear view, and I always make sure that I do at least one from the side to make sure that I'm not lying to myself about my depth, especially on heavy day, right? Because on heavy day, there's a tendency to cut it off, right? You want to get just to your depth and no deeper and drive your hips. So on heavy day, I'll do the three-quarter view. It gives me a lot of information about the squat. But if I think I'm just below parallel, I'm gonna bring the camera around to the side and look from the side and make sure that I'm not lying to myself about my depth.
Doesn't matter how high the camera is.
You have to experiment with that a little bit. But again, I think that in the three-quarter rear view, the height of the camera is more of an issue with looking at your depth. If the camera's a little bit higher, a little bit lower, it can give you a slightly distorted view of where your depth is. But from the side, if you put it like right at the level where your hip and knee should be, right there at the level of your femur, where your femur is going to be when you're at the bottom, right? Put the camera there, record it right from the side, right? You're going to know if you're high or not, right? So I always record at least one set from that angle.
Yeah, all that.
And for my online clients, right, I'll frequently have them record, you know, one set. If I'm concerned about their depth, I'll have them record one set from the side, not so much for me as for them, so that they can see, you know, like, look, dude, you really are high, right? Or you really are too deep. Look how deep you are, right? You're so deep, and it's causing your hips and your knees to shift forward. Kind of thing. So
useful to record each set and look and then adjust in lieu of having somebody that watching you every rep. I know you guys train together, right? So you can work on each other, but even for your own purposes, yeah, definitely. When I'm training in a heavy cycle, I'm always recording set to set, rep to rep, and I got coaches in my gym and I'll still just video my sets and look at them.
Yeah. The coach in your back pocket. Yeah. Just use it. Fun. You take one or two more questions. You guys find
lifts. When, if ever, should we use them?
What?
Accessory lifts, other than the big five. Do you ever incorporate other lifts?
I'll jump in one.
Because I don't use them a lot.
And I really don't either. Okay. The long and short of the matter, it all comes down to the goals of the lifter. I hate to keep going back to that, but it totally depends on what your goals are as a lifter and what you're trying to accomplish. Some people enjoy training. and it's an outlet, and it's a fun thing, and you want to train, and they want to train more. And there's some usefulness for the accessory lifts. They're all dialed into the book. Rip lays out all the useful ones. I think that once you exhaust your novice LP, if you're trying to get bigger and stronger, then adding in some hypertrophy and some bodybuilder-type movements is useful. I like close-grip bench press. I like the barbell row. I like chin-ups and pull-ups. I like curls. I like lying tricep extensions. And that's about it. And dips and push-ups, I'll say that as well. And then I like the Olympic lifts and their variants. And that's about it. In terms of accessories, give me a more specific.
That's what I was just asking, which ones do you like using?
All the stuff laid out in the book, the Olympic lifts, their variants, I think strongman stuff can have some usefulness for some conditioning. I mean, I love to train, so I think they all have their purpose. It just kind of depends on what you're trying to accomplish. But the vast majority of people I train that come into me as novices, they do the basic lifts. That's pretty much what they do. And if they hit a certain point where they've actually exhausted all that and there's a specific goal we're working on, then we'll start adding in. But 90% of the lifters I've trained, the basic lifts, some chin-ups, some pull-ups, like I mentioned, the close grip or curls, lying tricep extensions, but yeah, you don't need them.
You don't worry about like the sticking points on lifts or whatever and doing some weird, very, board presses if you have trouble.
I don't. But I don't train power lifters, and I can see some usefulness if you enjoy training a lot and you're a power lifter. I understand some of that stuff, but no, I've never. Most people just need to get stronger. Two guys.
So, what are your thoughts about the usefulness of the rate of perceived exertion as a training tool in training intermediates? Novices, I know it probably doesn't make a whole lot of difference, but in terms of its usefulness as a
sit down. All right. So let's. So. Look, again, it's a lot of heat and a little light.
Okay, I'll jump in for a second.
Go ahead.
I'll jump in. This is a long thing, and there's no.
And
don't
too
have
much
the time.
Has been made of it.
Far too much has been made of it. I don't have the time to even go into the depths of the whole conversation. But I don't even want to start.
Look,
I've used it for some of my lifters in the past. In the terms of, as long as I've been coaching at a certain...
I love how you waited until 3:45 to bring this shit up. Right? That's like...
No point at me, it's him.
Yeah. Well done.
As a tool... as a tool for somebody training on their own to guide the effectiveness of their training... That's what you're asking. Mm-hmm. How? Because yeah. I mean, rate of perceived exertion has been around for a long time. When I was an ultra runner and marathon runner, like, okay, is that hard? Is that easy? I mean, I just look at it as heavy, medium, light. And when I read practical programming, it made a lot of sense to me because I knew it from an exercise science background. Is it hard? Is it medium? Is it light? You know, if you're a runner, you know the junk zone, you know the intense zone, you know what all that is. So, is it hard? Is it medium? Is it light? So when I read practical programming, I looked at heavy, medium, light, and I said, okay, well, that's like ratings of perceived exertion. Like a medium day is a medium day, and how you define that. My experience is most lifters that have not been coached in our model don't have the proper execution of the movements. They don't know how to lift properly, and they haven't been coached on how to lift properly. And I don't think they have enough experience training to make a guided choice on that. I think they would need a coach. In lieu of having access to a coach or having proper coaching and how to properly do that stuff, I don't know. I guess I don't know enough about it. But to me, at a certain stage, when you've gone through a novice program, you get into your longer term goals, and if you're going to train heavy, medium, and light, I think that you break it down into a heavy, medium, light. And if you're going to look at it from a ratings of perceived exertion standpoint, then I guess that's, it is what it is. That's not a great answer. There's a lot of layers I could get into it with, but my experience is most people don't know how to do the lifts, and they actually haven't run a novice program. So for them to be able to self-guide themselves on it, marginal at best, but for the results I've seen compared to people that have been coached in person.
I think I've come off online as being a real RPE hater. I'm not an RPE hater. I'm an RPE doubter, right? Which is not the same thing. So there's no question in my mind that for some advanced athletes that it seems to have become a, a thing, and that some people might derive a benefit from it. I view it as, it's kind of like an accessory lift, right? Like somebody who does pin presses or something like that, right? It's an advanced technique. Its usefulness, I don't believe, has been definitively established, but a lot of people swear by it. I think it's been overused, especially if there's you're in a situation where there's one-on-one coaching going on. So if you have a coach, I don't think you need it unless you're a particularly advanced lifter, and maybe not even then. So, you know, I can look at what my lifter is doing on the platform, and, you know, for my intermediate lifters, where we're going to, where the training goals might shift during the day, where I'm wondering if her bar needs to be deloaded or whether she should push for a PR, right? Between her and I, we're going to know that without a numerical scale that professes to a high level of granularity, right? A high level of metric accuracy that I don't believe is warranted under most circumstances. The word, the sort of the buzzword that's out there right now is autoregulation. There needs to be an autoregulatory component to intermediate program, the post-novice program, and absolutely there does, right? And if RPE fulfills that criterion for you, and you like doing that, that's fine. I don't use it, right? I don't use it in my own training, and I don't use it in my gym. Again, I'm with Chris slightly different. It's like, you know, was that hard? Was that really hard? Or was that really fucking hard, right? Like that lift barely got up, and I'm not sure that more weight on that bar is going to be safe for her, right? It basically falls into those criteria. Look, so I've spent a career in medicine, and we had all these various both subjective scales and metric scales. So here's a classic example. The classic example is the Wells criteria for thromboembolic disease. So somebody presented to the emergency department, and you're worried that they've got a clot in their leg or a clot in their lung. And there's a thing called the Wells criteria. It's an explicit scoring system that allows you to derive a pretest probability. How likely is it that this person has a clot? And you get a score, right, that tells you what their pretest probability is. And then quite some time ago, somebody did a study where they took clinicians, experienced clinicians, and they would present the case to them in different ways. And they had one group, if I remember correctly, just come up with a Wells score. And then they had another group just say, now just tell us, what's your pretest probability? Is it, you know, high, low, what is it? And the guys who just sort of gestalted it and said, yeah, that guy's high probability, they got it right just as often without using the score. You understand what I'm saying? Then there's the whole issue of the, you know, of a subjective score, something like the visual analog scale for pain, which I never found useful in a single circumstance in 25 years of clinical practice, right? So I'm deeply suspicious of scoring systems that offer a high degree of metric accuracy in a situation where that degree of accuracy may not be warranted, a highly granular numerical scale. And I'm very suspicious of subjective scoring systems. That all said, again, it may be a useful parameter for some people. It does add a level of complexity to the programming. And the other concern that I have about it is, especially if you're working out without a coach, is, like I did heavy day recently. And if I had had a little score and a little spreadsheet that would have allowed me to come up with a number for my RPE and would have allowed me to not have to do my second set at that weight, I would have totally fucking gone for it, right? But I didn't, so I just had to do the second set and then the third. There was like no way out for me, right? Unless I think it's actually unsafe for me to try that weight again, I'm just going to do it. Right? And So I'm concerned that it's subject to a certain degree of misuse. I'm concerned that it's subject to a certain degree of misapplication for lifters who don't know how to use it yet. And I'm deeply suspicious of its use as a prescriptive instrument for determining what loads are to be lifted at a particular volume. Its use as a descriptor, right, which we use it, SSOC, some of my colleagues in SSOC use it, I don't know if you do or not, but some of my colleagues in SSOC use it as a descriptor where, the lifter comes back and says, yeah, that was an RPE of 9, and then they'll go back and say, dude, that was not an RPE of 9. That was an RPD of like 3, right? Because people don't know what's hard.
It's like when you do a set and it feels like it was a bone-on-bone limit and you look at the video and it goes.
Yeah. So it's a really tricky thing to implement, I think. I think it's subject to misapplication. I think it's subject to misuse. Do I think it doesn't work? No, I think that there's some people for whom it does work. Right? I know some strong people who use it. I know some people who stand by it in their coaching. I think we all know some people who stand by it in their coaching. And that's fine. Their model is different from mine. My model involves my eyeballs on every single work set, whether I'm an online coach or an in-person coach. And in that scenario, where my eyeballs are on the lifter for every rep of every work set, I find that I don't need it. But I coach masters, I coach novices and intermediates, and I don't coach people for competition, right? So maybe, maybe in those categories it's useful. I don't have a need for it, right? I don't think most of you have a need for it either. Is it possible that you'll get to the point where that level of training complexity will be salutary? I suppose it is, right? So again, I'm not an RPE hater. I'm just an RPE doubter. And you can consider me to be a terminally late adapter or adopter of that technique. It's going to take a lot for me to adopt that technique and use it in my coaching practice because I don't find that I need it any more than I need a Glasgow coma scale or a visual analog pain scale in my clinical practice of medicine. Other people use them. I think they're useless. That answer the question?
Yes, it did.
Okay.
I think the interesting thing about it all, and I think it's some of you guys that know and don't know what's going on, is the thing's growing. More people are becoming exposed to training and the idea of getting stronger, and that's a good thing. It's funny that there's arguments going on over little things like this. And
no, I think you've hit on something very. So there's been a lot of drama, and there's been a lot of controversy. Right. So, and there's been some butt hurt, right? But here's what it really boils down to. The reason that this is happening, all this drama and all this butt hurt and all this controversy, is because of the increasing recognition of the importance of strength for health and performance. And everybody involved, us guys, and those guys. At the end of the day, we all want the same thing. We want to help more and more people get stronger. There's some dispute about the optimal way to do that. That's okay, right? But my lifters all get stronger. I'm going to assume that their lifters all get stronger too, right? So that's good. And we want more people to be exposed to barbell training for strength, to strength training, to progressive overload, to stress recovery adaptation, to squats, presses, deadlifts, right? To get stronger, to get healthier, and to improve their performance. So there's drama and there's butt hurt, but I think what it all indicates is that something very positive is happening, right? That this whole thing is growing and it's reaching more people, right? and it's become more important to more people. And it's becoming something that people are thinking about and talking about very deeply. It's also become a very lucrative business. It's becoming an increasingly important part of the fitness industry. So this kind of thing was inevitable, right? Keep our eye on the ball. Let's get more people strong. Let's use programs that work. Let's constantly reevaluate what we do, and let's not get anybody hurt. Safe, productive training, right? And I think everybody wants that, right? And 10 years from now, everybody will have evolved in their position in one way or another. Because if they haven't, then that's not healthy. Everybody should be learning. Everybody should be evolving. I don't program people the same way I did 4 years ago, right? I don't coach people the same way I did 4 years ago. So I think that regardless of all the vitriol, I think this is all actually very positive, right? And I don't wish anybody ill. I don't think they necessarily wish us ill either. I think it's all part of the growth of this you know, phenomenal transformation of our ideas about fitness and health. I think it's ultimately very, very good. And I encourage, you know, I encourage the discussion about it. And I'm glad that you guys felt comfortable asking these questions today. So I think that's as good a place as any for us to end it. I think that you all did very, very well. You were a great bunch to work with. You were great in the Q&A. It was a lot of fun. And thank you very, very much for coming out today. Yeah, appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.